So, there are a lot of myths and that are propagated by the media.
Hi, I'm Stuart. I have a medical science degree, and that was Christopher Randolph speaking at the 2015 USA National Sport Concussion Summit. So today I'm going to go over what I perceive are the top six sport concussion myths as understood by the general public. Brain health and sport concussion are areas that are filled with misconceptions and misunderstandings by the average person off the street. For the purposes of the video, I'm going to deal with things that are well established and have been repeatedly shown, rather than dealing with things that are still contentious and up in the air. So myth number one is that the brain is incapable of producing new brain cells after being damaged after a blow to the head. However, you can take it a step further to say that a lot of people are stuck with a disproved belief that the adult brain is incapable of producing new brain cells, period.
And then in the late 1990s, they realized that's not true. Actually, the brain makes new brain cells throughout our entire life.
Far from the idea that you are born with one predetermined number of brain cells, and any bump on the head, such as heading a football, will decrease that number, in reality, the brain produces new brain cells throughout adult life, and this process is heightened after a brain injury. Myth number two is that CTE only occurs in people who have had prior exposure to contact sports. Looking at one published study, they found that 5 of the 6 cases with no known history of neurotrauma appeared to meet the consensus criteria for CTE. I will leave a link in the description to all the studies that I reference in this video. Myth number three is that rest is the best recovery from a bad concussion.
We at the University of Cincinnati will often recommend for concussion patients and TBI patients an hour on a treadmill or an exercise bike, an hour and 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. We want them to get to the cardio.
Those were the words of Joe Clark, a neurologist and sport concussion expert, talking about his post-concussion protocol. There are several studies out there on this issue, but looking at one, they compared one group who avoided standard daily tasks and another who returned to daily tasks. The group who had the mental and physical stimulation of the daily task activities achieved recovery first. Obviously, if an injury was sustained during a contact sport, then it wouldn't make sense to return to that while symptomatic. And if you have a concussion, you are better off talking to a neurologist. But as a guideline, rest is really the answer. So myth number four is that combat sports athletes automatically have a low IQ. Information on an average value might be difficult to obtain, but it can certainly be said that this isn't true 100% of the time. There are 3 boxers who have been admitted to Mensa over the last several decades. These are Henry Milligan, Nicky Piper, and Bobby Zies. The contact sports athletes with a high IQ could not only be found in the world of professional boxing, but also in the world of American football. Ryan Fitzpatrick scored an impressive 48 out of 50 on the Wunderlic test, a known challenging cognitive abilities test. Intelligent players can also be found in the National Hockey League. Alex Killon graduated from Harvard with a 3.5 GPA. Myth number 5 is that CTE is always a symptomatic condition.
You look at some systematic reviews. For example, a paper by Gardner a few years ago or a couple of years ago in the British Journal of Sports Medicine, very good review, and he found that maybe 25% of the cases of CTE were pathology negative, 25% of the patients were asymptomatic.
That was Rudy Castellani talking at the 2015 USA National Sport Concussion Summit. A link to the Gardner review is in the description. Myth number 6 is that brain injury is the sole determinant of post-concussion symptoms.
So when we look at emergency department studies where we enroll people who have had concussions as well as people who have had orthopedic injuries, at 6 months after the injury, after your emergency department admission, your score on a post-concussion scale is not predicted by whether or not you had a concussion at all. So brain injury is not even a predictor.
So that was Dr. Randolph talking again in 2015. What this comes down to is the myth that you have essentially no control over your brain health. And on that note, you could check out my video, 6 Ways to Improve Brain Health. Or if not, thank you for watching.